This project began with the late Harry Gosling, who is sadly no longer with us. This audio story is dedicated to him and everyone involved in this project, and we send our condolences to his family. Situation was disastrous, even more so than it would have usually been. The doctor had disappeared, vanished in a spark of light from the control panel, a panel of which was clearly malfunctioning. The cylinder at the top was still, however, moving up and down within the console as expected, entering and exiting the amalgamation of the controls soldered into the panel. It wasn't, however, doing so at its usual leisurely pace. Instead, it was manoeuvring at such a speed that if it was to go any faster, Perry thought that it would simply dart away, separating itself from the ship it was bolted to. The panel itself wasn't doing much better. The various lights within it were flashing vigorously as alarms blared in a very distressing tone. Perry covered her ears with her hands in the process, as the various noises were beginning to give her a headache. She thought to herself as the TARDIS flew through the vortex in agony.
Oh, the engine's whining a bit more than usual. Oh, well, where's the doctor? Where's he gone?
She exclaimed to herself, and saying that, she began to stress. The doctor's ship was currently flying through the very essence of time itself, with no doctor, no pilot. Usually, she loved the break without the Time Lord, as the pair often engage in arguments and conflicts, but not in the case where his ship was in flight without him. After all, Perry herself could not operate the craft. The interior began to shake, and sparks erupted from the console, throwing Perry down to the floor. She felt that this was her end, that this was how she was going to die. It wasn't even heroic. It was due to nothing other than her recklessness. She wished that she never stepped on board this police box at that moment. So, in one last attempt, she did the only thing that she knew to do in such horrific moments. The only thing that she knew that worked. Well, at least in all other cases. She called his name, expecting no response, except she just got the opposite.
Oh, hello?
A polite voice replied. This took Perry back in surprise, causing her to look up in curiosity. In the previously empty console room, there now stood a man beside the controls. A young man. A man that wore a blue jumper and braces, followed by a grey blazer and trousers of the same colour. This stranger felt familiar, but not quite. He was shorter than the doctor, with a matching, less vulgar dress sense.
Sorry, who are you?
Perry asked the man, of whom now carefully began to operate the controls, avoiding the sparking flares, as he calmly paced around the damaged console. The stranger, however, seemed unaffected by the ship shaking, presumably somehow being used to the experience. Soon after, the man stopped, and then slowly glanced through the violently lifting rotor.
Well, I believe you already know. After all, you did just call my name.
This confused Perry. That much was evident in her facial expressions. She brushed herself off and stepped up from the floor in the process, attempting to steady herself on the walls of the shaking TARDIS. This man had no need to balance himself. Couldn't possibly be claiming what she believed he had just claimed.
No,
she exclaimed to herself.
That couldn't possibly be the case. He couldn't have done it again. He just couldn't.
She thought to herself. But in the slight chance that he did, maybe it would be better that she just asked. So she did.
So, did you regenerate?
She questioned, a puzzled tone forming in her voice. She thought again. How could he possibly be the doctor? He wasn't even wearing that hideous coat. The last time that this occurred, he was still wearing the clothes of his predecessor. She continued to think, maybe this was one of his other selves later in the timeline. Like that strange one with the Beatles haircut. The man shook his head, finally responding to Perry's question.
Well, not quite.
That statement gave Perry a reason for concern. She then took a deep breath and slowly attempted to reach his stranger, but claimed to somehow be the doctor. She grasped for various roundels within the wall as she began to reach the portion of the console room that contained the man.
Then how can you be the doctor?
She asked. Because if he hadn't just regenerated, then what exactly was going on? Why was there another man claiming to be another version of her friend, now operating the damaged vessel? She was concerned, and she wanted answers. Meanwhile, this unfamiliar entity continued to operate the controls as he thought up a response.
Well, I am what you would call a parallel incarnation,
he claimed, swiftly going back to operating the damaged controls, returning with a question of his own in the process.
May I ask for your name, child?
He asked in a rather polite tone, a tone that took Perry by surprise. She then thought to herself for a moment, could she trust this man claiming to be a parallel incarnation of a friend? She then reluctantly answered,
Perfect Gillian Brown, but Perry works too.
At that moment, another question entered Perry's mind, a question of which she immediately asked.
What do you mean by parallel?
This caused the so-called doctor to sigh, before he then halted the flickering of the switches once more.
Look, Perry, I'm a parallel version of the doctor,
he stated in a slightly irritated manner, before he then continued.
The thing is, I am him, but from another universe. And if I'm correct in my knowledge, I should even be the same incarnation number.
However, Perry still wasn't satisfied.
So, if you're him, but from another universe, then where's my doctor?
She asked, still struggling to stay steady, as the craft itself shook in pain. She then attempted to continue speaking to this parallel variant of a friend, this doctor in grey and blue, of which paused before answering the question.
Well, to answer your question, Perry, I believe with full confidence we swap places. He is most certainly in my previous position within my own TARDIS. Don't worry, your doctor's fine.
This doctor turned to Perry.
Oh, by the way, is that an American accent I hear? I take it you're my other self's current travelling associate?
Perry's brows narrowed, as if this man had just asked the most obvious question in the history of obvious questions, because, well, he had in fact heard.
Well, I thought that was obvious,
Perry eventually retorted.
Is there an issue with that?
This took the doctor back. He wasn't quite expecting such a response.
No, absolutely not. I was merely curious. I'm sorry if I may have offended you, Perry.
He looked back down at his controls, clearly ashamed. He wasn't intending to offend Perry. After all, he was merely curious. The room went silent. Well, as silent as a room could go in its current condition. It still shook violently and the engine screeched in distress as the console created this light show. Finally, Perry decided to take the leap and ask his doctor what he was doing with her doctor's TARDIS.
So what exactly are you doing with the controls?
Perry questioned.
Are you attempting to land the TARDIS?
Once more, he looked back at Perry. This time, however, it was only for a brief moment before again returning to fiddling with the console.
In a way, yes. In another way. Not quite.
He thought for a moment, before figuring out the best manner of exposing his intentions to Perry.
Well, you see, I've been using the dimensional circuits of this TARDIS to communicate with those of mine. After all, this is all down to a slight error.
This Grey Doctor paused for a moment.
An error? Of which, caused myself and your doctor have swapped places. Oh dear.
He stopped and scratched his head.
Fear not. I'm attempting to repair them from this control panel in order to restore us both back to our appropriate positions in existence. Only thing, I'm assuming your doctor is to... is to be a tad confused at this present moment. You know, having just been flung across the very multiverse itself. Without a warning.
Perry had been rather quiet for a period, allowing this incarnation to explain. Although he now detailed out the current circumstances to her, she simply couldn't get one thing out of her mind.
So, this is your fault?
She asked, with a slight hint of annoyance.
Your TARDIS caused this?
Again, this other doctor exhaled, nodding slowly afterwards.
Yes, quiet,
he replied.
I imagine this, error caused some of the vessel circuits to overload. It's causing a lot of this racket we seem to be experiencing right now. And I imagine the same issues to be occurring within my own craft. At which, your doctor is currently on, which is bad indeed. But there is still hope for that young child. I told you your doctor will be fine, and I will make sure he returns back to where he belongs. Fear not, Pepper Gilliam.
Hera had a sudden thought whilst picturing her doctor and his patchy distasteful choice of garments, stranded and clueless within a parallel universe within a parallel malfunctioning TARDIS. A thought that surprisingly amused her.
Not people, Perry. I happen to be me.
Whatever else happens, I am the Doctor.
She imagined him to be jolting about, rushing in an attempt to stabilise his vessel, of which belonged to an alternative version of himself. Why? Why wasn't this Doctor like her Doctor? Why didn't he appear to be the same? Where was his curly blonde hair? Where was his lack of manners?
Poor pusillanimous Perry. What a pitiful performance.
Where was his attire? She thought to bring it up. So, why aren't you like him? She asked, in a surprisingly calmer tone than most of her exchanges between the Doctor thus far. He chuckled, as if the question was humorous. Or maybe it was. Perhaps the reasoning behind why he wasn't was the most simple thing he'd ever heard. Or perhaps not. Perry was just about to find out.
Well, assuming you meaning why I'm not quite like the variant of myself that you know. The reasoning behind that is that these different universes that diverge from one another, where one thing may have occurred in this reality, it may not have occurred within my own.
Perry was still not quite following the common shifting of the other Doctor's use of his personal pronouns that further confused her mind. Something that no doubt this version would continue to do. Her expression extended upon a current confusion. It reflected a mannerism that suggested that she wanted this man to elaborate on. Thus he did.
Well, it's perfectly simple. Within my universe, I most likely regenerated into my current body, henceforth myself. Hello. Of that, or the different reasoning to that of myself, your doctor, within his body. Which is all my TARDIS.
With this grey and blue garmented doctor paused for a moment, backtracking to ensure that it operated the correct controls, before eventually returning to doing such again, continuing his explanation in the process.
So, due to the factor of regeneration, most likely occurring at different places and times, my molecule shifted in a different form from the doctor that you know.
With this, the TARDIS began to settle at one last operation of the man. The sparks halted, and the shaking stopped.
Oh, thank God.
That's better.
Even the engines returned to their normal level of wheezing. The doctor smiled as he took a step back from the console, sticking his hands in his trouser pockets. In this moment, Perry finally relaxed for the first time since encountering this other doctor. She felt comfortable seeing this man in his current proud position. He finally felt like the doctor that she knew. She now decided to slowly approach him.
So, what now?
She questioned. This younger doctor stayed put, his eyes still fixed on the console, even now that he stood away from it.
Nothing. If all goes according to plan, both our TARDIS capsules should, theoretically, be back to their regular functionalities. And everything should go back to normal.
He sighed, before finally turning back towards Perry.
Well then, I believe we shall be our last moments together, Pepper Gilliam. It was a pleasure knowing you for a short time, and I'm dreadfully sorry for the inconvenience. Do give your doctor my sincere apologies.
With this, Perry looked up at the man, a man whom just a few minutes ago was a complete stranger, but not a man whom now she'd consider as a friend.
So, does that mean you're going back?
This doctor nodded slowly before opening his mouth.
I believe that to be the case, yes.
Now, for two people who barely knew one another, they seem remarkably disappointed to be leaving one another's company so soon. He slowly spoke once more.
I believe that your doctor will return soon.
He looks down to the floor, which Perry couldn't help but do exactly the same.
One last phrase was muttered by Miss Variant.
Do inform your Variant upon what has occurred. I suspect it won't do.
Perry began to look up once more, preparing to reply to the Doctor's statement, but before she could do so, he was already gone. Instead, in his place, stood her Doctor, in his eye-watering attire. Normality had restored. Well, as much as it could do in Perry's current lifestyle. Doctor Who, The Wrong Universe. Written, directed and produced by Harry Gosling. Narrated by Lewis Wheelhouse. Artwork by Kieran Bufton and edited by Lewis Wheelhouse. This is a non-profit fan-made audio production and is in no way associated with the BBC. This audio production is one of the final pieces of work to be ever made by Harry Gosling before he passed away at the age of 19. A true, passionate storyteller, a master of his craft, and our dear friend. Harry Gosling, 2004 to 2023.